Today's talk focuses on the Tesla expansion of supercharger facilities in inner city location or high density location, and probably the most beautiful location thus far, I believe, is something called the Inner Harbor in Maryland. And today we take a look at goods and bads of the inner city installation and the specific location at the Inner Harbor at Maryland. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Thanks once again for taking time out to join us. Bonjour, wie geht's? Здравствуйте. If this is your first time on our channel, please take time to like and subscribe. If you're a returning visitor, welcome back. Today's talk is a little bit on the mundane side. Often we cover some pretty wide-ranging issues, but I was really fascinated by the fact that Tesla has now switched gears. Hong Kong has benefited from inner city locations for superchargers for a long time in all of their large apartment or large buildings that house Tesla cars and owners. In the United States, we're just starting to get what I call inner city locations, or locations that are within 5 or 10 miles from city center of many of the major cities. I was fascinated by the fact that I kind of stumbled or ran into, while doing a meeting by phone, I ran into the location in Maryland and had a chance to sort of take a look at the facility as well as talk with a few owners and see what they think of it. And, you know, sort of some suggestions both for owners and Tesla sort of came out of the exposure. So I've listed some of the goods and bads. You can see them on the list. The owner I spoke with was particularly upset because the challenge with this Tesla location is that it's one of the best located parking areas for the entire facility. And as a result, you have a lot of non-Tesla owners parking there. So if you choose to travel the 95 corridor through Washington, D.C. area, or if you're, you know, just a regular user, you'll find that it can be challenging to get access when there are sort of high profile or high demand events that are going on. So in general, I'd say it's an awesome facility because it's beautiful. 50 to 100 restaurants within a quarter or half mile of the location, all kinds of events around the calendar year. I actually think that in the future, Tesla will likely have to add a second location to address the needs of the number of, you know, Model 3s, etc., that'll be in the greater DC area that want charging abilities. You know, the other suggestion is that there's charging to the north in a place called Laurel, Maryland, or south in a place called Woodbridge, which may be better if you don't want to deal with some of the headaches that are associated with this location, but I think it is a great spot to charge at. The one aspect that I'd like to cover more aggressively is the whole idea that Tesla monitors your vehicle and will charge you if you overstay your location. So there's a way for them to know where you are and what you're doing. And I wonder if they shouldn't also just go ahead and include the price of parking, because you will have to pay that anyway. And it eliminates potential for overages by you staying too long. So I just think that it makes no sense for this to occur. I sort of developed an interest in this whole area because one of the problems in the inner cities, particularly older inner cities like Washington, D.C., is there are a large number of buildings that don't have very good charging facilities. Most of them want you to work with a 110 power cable, and it takes forever for the car to recharge. So I believe that there's going to be a real need for expansion of the number of inner city locations. I do think, you know, including parking in the charge that Tesla does is a good idea, because you can be on a bulk plan where it'll cost less based on, you know, just that corporate relationship for the sort of acquisition of power in those parking spaces. I just, you know, some creativity I think is really needed. I was kind of fascinated by this whole area because there's a Model S owner who I'm indirectly friends with, and he lives in an apartment building that only offers a 110 charge and is a doctor, so his work schedule can have him out late at nights, etc., So it's hard to get contiguous large amounts of time to charge on. So as a result, he has ended up in some really tricky situations of running out of power because he wasn't home long enough to get the charge done. And then all of a sudden, you know, he's sort of out at work and it's cold and the battery goes dead. So I just think, you know, it's still challenging for inner city owners to be a Tesla owners in the United States. But I'm hopeful with the change to pay for your facilities, et cetera, it'll work out. If I were to give a grade for this location, I would say I think you would probably get a B+, probably an A-, because of several reasons. Number one, the awesome number of restaurants. Number two, it's right next to 95, the major freeway moving through the area. Number three, you know, just a beautiful setting overlooking the water. One of the Tesla owners that I ran into kind of come up with a sneaky plan where he just sits in his car while it's charging and reads or something, and that eliminates the parking fee. And, you know, it sort of brings up before one of the bad aspects is that not only Tesla can see where you're at, but the parking lot's embedded with sensors, so it knows when cars are sitting there that are not paying the parking fee, and will send a note to the parking attendant, who I'll put a picture of, that brings the authorities quickly to capture revenue that you're not providing. So if you do use this location, definitely pay for parking, because these guys have a very sophisticated management process to make sure that anybody parking will be nabbed. I guess I don't have a huge amount to add to it in general. I think it's a great location. I think it's beautiful. I think they definitely need way more charging facilities for places like Washington, D.C., given the coming Model 3 ownership numbers. And number four, I really think there needs to be more integration between the charges for parking, et cetera, that Tesla's doing, and the locations that have been chosen, because I think that the volume will lower the overall cost of charge for owners. You know, the volume relationship will lower the cost for owners. But I'm wondering if, you know, they shouldn't be discounting heavily that parking location, given the value of having those Tesla customers at their facility for 1 or 2 hours and the restaurant revenue that's generated by their presence. These are not issues that are typically dealt with in remote locations, because in those locations, you just don't have enough demand. And therefore, the Tesla customers are creating demand for those restaurants. Those folks are really happy to have them. So I just think there needs to be a really carefully thought through policy process for how to deal with the new inner city locations and how customers sort of are treated by everybody considered, including the mall owners, restaurants, parking people, etc. I'm also wondering if there isn't a need in the intercity locations to start providing scheduling times, because as the number of vehicles increase, I can see peak times being overwhelmed with people. And frankly, you could charge more if you want to park and charge at certain times versus others, I think is something that kind of makes sense going forward. I'm looking forward to all of your comments based on the goods and bads list that I gave you. Simple video, not as complex as we usually do. The only other thing I'd like to cover is kind of looking at what's happening with the Model 3. I want to encourage those of you who are now getting your cars to really take time to sort of check out goods and bads of your vehicle and make sure that you put the information back through the feedback loop so that those can be repaired for ongoing customers. Final note is thanks for taking time out once again. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Tschüss, macht's gut, au revoir, Heathrow, Hoda Hafez.
based on focuses